moderator today. So, this play, Maria Kizito, this is the second time they've done it. And the first time they did it was in New York in 2012 as part of Soulographie. But before this, they worked together with the director, Emily Mendelsohn, on a play written by Deborah Sime, Cooking Oil. For those of you who watched it, you may remember. Yes. And the thing is that Maria Kizito is not a play in isolation. So the work they did in Cooking Oil built up to the performance they had today. So I felt it was important for me to first mention this so that at least we don't think it was this production only that happened. So there's been a history of collaboration with people from different cultures as a result. Well, the play was written by Professor Erik Ehn and directed by Emily Mendelsohn, produced by ArtSpot Productions in New Orleans, and the scenic design was done by Jeff Becker. And the performers, Alan, Esther, Tony Mangala, Lauren Fenton,
Sherry Marina, Monica.
So there have been a number of performers who you can't see here. They're just representing a larger cast that went into this production. So, yes, Alan, would you like to say something? I may have to.
Okay, the collaboration was such an intense process that was nice of you to tell a story. Telling a story about the genocide was great, but doing the play as Maria Kizito was one of the stories that led us to question ourselves as in what role did we play when the genocide occurred in that period, and that is in that period, but as now, because Maria Kizito is a play that always reproduce most times, not only to remember the genocide as it happened, but all the genocides around the world, and to ask ourselves what contribution we have then, and to actually remind ourselves that this genocide or choices we make actually happen up to today. This is something that just did happen in the past, but even up to now, we do make choices. But the whole point is what choices we make as individuals when we see such things or atrocities happen as individuals.
Okay, interestingly, my first question was going to be related to that. So, as an actress in the production, what memories does this play conjure up? Because you just talked about the fact that there were all these genocides that happened,
yeah.
And the one at least that's closest to us is the Rwandan genocide. So, what memories does this conjure up for you?
As a little girl, the genocide happened when I was about like 7 years old, 7, 8 years old. The one memory I have from back then is I was told never to eat fish during that period. Then I didn't understand fully what was happening, but I remember being told by my father the fish from the lake actually has like watches and human hands, and that was really creepy. So from what I remember back then is we never had fish for a long period of time until I think of recent in my memory. That's what I remember from that, and that's the memory I really do have from that genocide.
Okay. Esther, what memories when you're in this production?
I don't know if this is actually possible, but I was in Shimoni. It doesn't exist anymore. For reasons we all understand if you're in Uganda. So, I remember going to the school tap after the break, after break, and opening the tap to wash my hands, and hair came out of the tap. I've never said this to anyone because I don't understand how water that we hear all people claim to be recycled or to be, I don't know, treated or something. I don't know if this water comes from a lake. I want to sound very, very naive right now, but hair actually came out of the tap. And the fish story, that one, I have the same story. My grandmother stopped eating fish. And I can only relate those stories to what happened in Rwanda because I was too young to understand what was happening.
Okay, you have these memories. Like, did you use these memories to inform the way you were approaching the work, or was it some, okay, did you use these memories as you approached the work?
It's really interesting that you asked that. I don't know, I should put it this way. Doing the text the first time, I was at university in my second year, and we had a reading performance of it. Back then, I was so emotionally attached to it, borrowing from those memories, and it was hard to actually tell the story with your own emotions, because then you're judging, and you're choosing for the audience what story to look at. But then having met the director, Emily Mendelsohn, she's one very brilliant director that actually, in the process of actually producing this play, she has exercises and style, you call it a style, of actually teaching you to be a vessel in which you do not subject to emotional attachment, you learn to part from it and be able to tell the story. Because her style is to use us as vessels, not to judge the characters in the play, and not to choose for the audience what direction of the play they should look at, but rather to tell the story without any attachments. And I could say, yeah, I somehow put my stories, my emotional stories aside, and actually as an actress, learn to do the play and allow myself to be molded. I'll just give an example. If you got up there, most of the productions you have I could just say, like, I could use the director Stanislavski. He's one of the directors that I've studied in my drama classes, and that is the approach that we mostly use in Uganda for most of the productions. While compared to Emily's direction, it's more abstract. For example, if I use the image of light, at some point you'd hear the words, and all you could see was a bit of fire, and then there's the milk being poured. I think her style is more of not choosing to tell you what you have to pick out, but to let you let with the choices she has chosen. It's more a bit of abstract, and I think in Uganda we do not have that much abstract theatre, I could say.
First of all, these people take the theater as everything. They almost lay their souls down for this thing, which doesn't pay. But in Uganda, if something doesn't pay after a while, we let it go. But these people write grants in the night and wake up. This guy is 50, but he's there. Like, for us at 18, we were like, where's the money? Like, like this amazed me, like completely and totally amazed me, like how these people do not stop. Someone is attending a class by Skype, like she does rehearsals with you and goes back to attend a dance class by Skype. Like, I can't, we don't do that here. I wish we did it like that. I wish we do this thing like, if I don't do this, I will die. But we take it like, where is the next money? Like, when do I get paid? The guy, where is my money? And you don't put as much soul into this thing. I feel like that's what I saw. And these directors don't feed you. In Uganda, the director tells you, stand like this.
Yeah.
Sit like this. So if you move this hand, put it here. Like, they give you the choice. Like, you ask. For example, what should I do here? She goes, what do you think you should do? That is surprising to me. Like, you give me the choice to choose how to stand. And then that becomes a challenge. Like, I don't know how to stand. Tell me how to stand. So I feel like that is so different, and I wish maybe we do in some of those things. I believe that we'll probably be able to produce like something, you know, something that's more challenging to watch, and maybe for someone to watch and think and ask questions and not just go like, I understood the play from the beginning, but maybe have questions they have after the show.
Just to add on that.
Yes.
I remember when we did a piece in 2012. We had the script, it's a very hard piece, the language, the subject matter, but from that first time we worked on it, I remember saying, I think I wish it could be half or more disciplined like the actors we worked with back in New York and even New Orleans that we do not have back at home. When we are called for rehearsals, for instance, many times, a director calls you for rehearsals and you take the director for granted. I think it's genuinely, like almost all the productions I've been in, you find the cast is late, they do not communicate. Like generally the heart or the love of what you're doing is not there. It's basically like she's saying all about money, but if you can really understand. And back then in New York we had Dana, a fellow cast member who actually, I learned something from her, watching her do her part was really interesting. This is someone who picked her script even after we've done the reading and we're on, like off script. During the night, she sits down and keeps breaking down her script layer after layer beyond what the director has actually given us and beyond what we've worked on. Like every new day, there is something new you discover within your script underneath your lines. And that I appreciated so much. I kept telling Esther, man, this feels like an exam. Like every night, I have to go through my script. It feels like I'm going to sit for an exam the next day. But the beauty about it is that every time we do the production, I don't know, we had 6 productions in New Orleans, but not one single one of them was the same. Today we have a production, so the same as the next one. There's always something new you discover in the new run, in the next run. And that is just beautiful, just you can't stop discovering things. But back here at home, we cram. The problem is we cram. We don't let ourselves create, we don't let ourselves think deeper. I think that's the whole big difference that we should, I don't know, borrow from that.
Okay, so. Over to you, lovely audience. Yes, I think I'm being signaled. Can I give you guys a chance to ask a few questions to these lovely ladies, and then I'll move around this lovely mic.
Okay, this goes to Alan. I'm glad that you went through that experience. And now that you went through that experience, what were the influences behind the story? Because what I experienced here, the story was deep for the audience. Now, what was the influence that helped you to bring out the story in your art? Because now what happens, what I'm trying to bring here is, what is underneath genocide, because you ask somebody what genocide is really about, and people really don't know. The bone marrow mind.
Genocide.
Yeah. So, how did you manage to explore that? Thank you.
Okay, shall we take another one before I go back up?
Yes. I'm happy this was screened in 2014, 20th anniversary of the Rwandan genocide. And so I would have two observations. One about the anniversary, but second about the Rwandan government and society in general is very conscious and critical about the way this story is told. And I think this is a true depiction based on their part. But what has been the response from their government and their society in general about the way this was portrayed?
Okay, I'll come back to the which one do you want to take first?
I'll take someone first. Okay, so go on, how we managed to tell the story, what was our influence? I would say, for the genocide, before we did the play, we got a chance to research a bit about the play and the genocide. Based on the history that I have read, yes, the genocide was basically carried out by the Hutus against the Tutsis, and basically it was a colonial era, of course, having different from colonialism, you know, there was the divide and rule, which whereby the Hutus were measured, their noses, if your nose was bigger than the Hutus. If your nose was big, then you were Hutu. Then if your nose was small, you were Tutsi. If you had more cows, definitely you were Tutsi. And if you had few cows, you were Hutu. It didn't matter exactly. So those were demarcations brought about by the colonialists. Yeah. How did that influence the story of the Maasai Renew? In the play, we do not generally tell the story as it is, because we have moments like the readings and the refugees that tell exactly what happened. Yes, but the way we approach the play from Emily's direction, the way we approach the play is not only to cite that one genocide in Rwanda, but to attach almost all the genocide. I could say in Uganda we've had our own genocide. For example, if we say, if we use the bombings that we had in 2010, yes, in New Orleans they've had their own through the hurricane.
Hurricane
Country, Katrina. Definitely, it's not just the genocide, but it's this mass killings that we have. Of course, now borrowing from those bits, we're able to tell the story. So the story is not just from the Rwandan genocide. That is like the black and white thing out there. But if you're not from the genocide era in Rwanda, what actually happened, what things have happened around you that you actually borrow from, or when we tell this story, that it helps you remember some of those genocides, that in the future, probably, you can make a wiser choice, because that is definitely not the end of genocide. That's when genocide is occurring even up to there as I speak. Hope I've answered you.
Okay, there was a question about consciousness of the Rwandan government.
Very briefly, I cannot speak for the Rwandan government, but I can speak for Erik Ehn, that heard about this story, heard about the genocide, and flew to Belgium and sat in on the trial of these two nuns. And his play is written off that trial. So from there he goes to Rwanda and lives in Soho, so that and that's why he did most of his research for this. So I don't know if this play has been shown in Rwanda, because these 37 pages are actually coming from 300 pages of French that he had to translate into English. So I can't speak for the reaction or what the Rwandan government has to say about this film. Yeah.
Okay. I will take one more because we... Just one more.
Maybe it's been sort of answered.
Okay.
So does that mean that many of the script was really interesting here, but a lot of what's in the script is actually an accurate account of what was said by Maria.
The nuns really live, they exist. The only person that is fiction is Teresa, because she's like representing Erik Ehn in this world of genocide. But all these characters exist in real life.
I guess that was my comment about that, and I felt that I came expecting to see a story about Maria Kizito, and then right in the center is this white lady with a suitcase. And it seemed to throw off the weight of the story. It's like, is this now a story again that's more focused on, you know, I hope I don't sound racist, but focus on this white person and not focus on trying to understand why Maria Kizito did what she did. And actually understand much more about why this lady came to see to witness the whole thing. Did you think about that? Did that disturb you? Was that not an issue at all? Was it? I know why she's there, but it seems to just really the weight of it seemed unbalanced to me.
Okay, this is the last question I'm taking. So we can continue a conversation, it will never end.
Well, yeah, you're not the first person to bring up this topic. Sure, in New Orleans, all the black people ask for
questions. Exactly.
And it turned into the black people asking why the white woman in the black people's play, why she tell the white black people's story. But I don't know why Erik chose to write it like that. But I also have my own question, like, why is the play Maria Kizito but told through someone else's eyes? I would have preferred to hear what Maria had to say. Because some of the few things, like she says, we served the refugees, we did this, my brothers were not in Tarahami. That's what he had in court. But what about what she did in Sovo? Does she have a chance to explain whether she was doing it under Mother Superior, or she was doing it because God visited her and told her to clean out? You know, I don't really understand. But your question is important.
Actually, I do think at the end of the day, Teresa is Erik Ehn. Yes, so we could not justify doing it because he's given us his interpretation of what he saw. That is how he saw the genocide. That was what he saw, and he left a bit confused, just like Teresa did. So it was his point of view. And it wasn't necessarily like a white story of choosing a white person. But maybe if a black person had gone and seen it and probably written it, maybe it would be there. But that was his point of view, that's what he saw, I think.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, time constrains us. However, there is another production.